Hello everyone, I'm Jonathan and welcome to A Better Question. Today I'll be telling you about a man you've probably never heard of, yet whose name you've said hundreds of times. He was an author, a diplomat, and a spy. The philosopher Voltaire praised his intellect, and Rousseau his morality. The king's favorite mistress admired him, Casanova complimented his character, and his name echoed through the streets of Paris in songs sung by courtesans. He tried to save his kingdom from violent revolution, and for this, his enemies nearly erased him from history. Yet, in a twist of irony, their efforts to destroy him instead ensured his name would outlast them all. And that name was Silhouette. This episode is the first of a new series, a series which explores common things named after people, and then asks, how'd that happen? As this is the first episode, I'm gonna take this many minutes to set up some context and scope for the series. But if you want to get right to it, you can skip ahead using the chapters down below on the timeline. Great, let's talk about names. Using names is something you do without even thinking about it. For language to even work, every thing, place, feeling, concept, whatever, has to have its own set of sounds if we're going to be able to talk about it with anyone else. Giving something a name is nothing less than attaching specific sounds to that thing. Fundamentally, any language is just an agreement between all of us about what names go with what things. You are unique in the universe, mostly. Well, you're certainly more unique than a table. You still need a name, though. So, to recognize that completely individual nature, most human languages give people proper names, like Lisa, or John. The problem is the demand for names is conceivably endless, and reserving a huge collection of them just for people could be a problem someday, because there's only so many sounds your speaky parts can do before things get uncomfortable. At the rate pharmaceutical companies are burning through new trademarked words, how long is it really gonna be before we get a pill named because it's the only legal option left? Luckily, we occasionally ignore the traditional separation between people names and thing names. If you need a word for a revolutionary new invention, the name of the inventor is a handy option. Phonetic variety aside, naming something after a person isn't a bad way to honor someone for an achievement or a discovery. And I suppose the opposite is also true. You can slap a person's name on something unpleasant to make sure everyone knows how much that person sucked. However it happens, as the years go by, the person is generally forgotten. What was once their individual name is now just a thing in the world. These special words that make the leap from a person to a thing also have a name. They're called eponyms. Rare as they are, there's still far too many eponyms for me to include all of them in this series. I'll be looking for common words for common things in common language, named after someone specific. Someone most people have never heard of or don't connect to the thing in question. And for this first episode, I've got a person who casts a shadow over all the rest, with a name that belongs at the head of the line. In the spring of 1759, France had been fighting the Seven Years' War for about 3 years. The war wasn't going super well, and to pay for it, the kingdom was hemorrhaging money. The king was staring at a budget statement with spending fully one-third more than income. The entire economic structure of French society, from its class system to its taxes, was, in a word, fucked. Onto this stage enters Étienne de Silhouette, the new Comptroller General for Finance. With the job came immense influence, and the power to shape almost every aspect of French society. But it also put Silhouette in the position of telling a king how to spend his money, all while trying to get enough money from everyone else to pay those expenses. On one hand, with the king more interested in gambling and chasing both game and mistresses, Étienne had a rare opportunity to enact his vision for what I would call a socialist monarchy. But on the other hand, was the whole everything is fucked thing. The war, looming bankruptcy, and a brewing rebellion against the backward oligarchy running the country into the ground. So, congrats on your promotion! That it was Silhouette the king selected to solve the hardest problem facing France was not an accident. The solution he eventually proposed was the product of a lifetime of study and an ironclad sense of personal morality, not to mention a huge set of balls. Silhouette was so well respected that he told a king he'd be withholding his allowance for things like gambling and keeping huge stables full of prize-winning horses. But in the face of this financial cluster, cost-cutting measures alone were as inadequate as a Civil War surgeon rocking around Gettysburg handing out band-aids and kisses. So Étienne de Silhouette threw himself into his work. He pored over the kingdom's accounting books, and he discovered some troubling facts. For one, the tax structure in France was insane. The king set the taxes, but a massive private company collected them, often by employing their own enforcers to encourage payment at the end of a pointy stick. The tax collectors took a cut of whatever they collected, but weirdly, then they would loan some of their embezzled millions to the kingdom at huge interest rates. So that was going well. Also, the nobility paid no taxes. They were exempt from most of them, but they could avoid the few they were supposed to pay through creative accounting measures or bribes. They'd do things like paying their income tax from their shabbiest of their seven estates. So it seemed like they made less money than they really did. Also, that estate happened to be located in the province with the lowest tax rate. What a coincidence. There was also the matter of noble pensions. These pensions were ongoing payments paid to the families and were granted by the king for reasons. These pensions were paid out from the treasury in return for doing absolutely nothing. And the largest could amount to fractions of a percent of the entire national budget, which might not sound like a lot, but to give you some perspective, that would be like the United States paying the Kennedys $600 million a year. And when there's dozens and dozens of these kind of payments, some military ranks and public offices also got pensions, but the size of those was microscopic in comparison, and those pensions were also awarded for, you know, work. Let's face it, we're talking about a system here where everyone has to do what this one person says. And in this case, that one person's grandma on his dad's side and granddad on his mom's side were also brother and sister. So that's also going well. The church didn't pay taxes either, not really. At one point, the king told them to, and they were like, nah. Instead, they donated a much smaller amount of their choosing. And because the king couldn't really do anything about it, he was, yeah, okay. But my favorite part of this system is that anyone with enough money could buy their way into the nobility. A lot of powerful civic positions were awarded in the same way. What a weird interview process. Do you have a letter of recommendation? Well, This job auction was so common that dreaming up new admin positions was a big source of income for the kingdom. It also meant the government and the military were bloated with useless positions staffed by morons. But you know who did pay taxes? Everybody else. In fact, being too poor to pay your taxes was a crime. If one of those pointy stick squads found some homeless peasant in a ditch, the fact he may be blind or have only one leg had nothing at all to do with how much tax he owed. Étienne de Silhouette, a humanist scholar who believed in things like the equality of all people, fiscal responsibility, and meritocracy, took in the totality of this arrangement and decided just f*** all of that. Silhouette was loyal to his king and country, but he also thought both had a responsibility to provide for their citizens. Silhouette thought blowing public money on luxurious vices was exactly the same thing as stealing food from a starving family. Yet, here they were, on the verge of bankruptcy and about to lose a war, while the nobility led lives that were extravagant by even today's standards. Silhouette changed things immediately. He went after the pampered nobility by taxing luxuries, like the number of servants, horses, or carriages. He canceled a lot of noble pensions without touching those pensions awarded for public service. And he either threw out or reduced taxes paid by the poor. Then he went after the bankers and tax collectors. He issued shares of that overarching tax collection company and made the company itself responsible to pay back interest on those shares. That decision alone brought in 72 million, however, money units. Finally, he went after the church. He wanted to sell off or at least mortgage some church property. And this huge sweeping plan immediately did two things. It made him the most famous man in all of France. The citizens of Paris literally sang songs about him in the streets. And it also took three separate groups that typically didn't play well together, the nobility, the new rich financiers that the older nobility hated, and the church, and it pushed them to unite against a common enemy for the first time ever. Was that enemy corruption? Poverty? The plight of their fellow man? The British? No, it was him. They hated him. But yay, unity! At this point, I wouldn't blame you for thinking, cool story, but none of that explains how the French nobility version of Cyril Figus got his name connected to a word meaning the outline of a thing. To be honest, I know how it happened and I'm still a little baffled. It's one of those circumstances that demonstrates the awesome, intricate variety in the story of humanity, and also makes you wonder how the hell we got this far. The final ingredient is the French court. The upper crust of French polite society was basically a middle school clique with super high stakes. Think Mean Girls, but the most popular one can up and decide to kick you out of school. Not just this school, every school. When they found out about Silhouette's creative fundraising, the who's who of French society decided he had to go. If you wanted to get rid of somebody, there were really weird rules for how you had to do it. Assassination, execution, or even political imprisonment, as we think of it, weren't really a thing for the elite of French society. In fact, between 1672 and the 1790s, there weren't any significant political murders in Europe or its colonies. There wasn't really a danger of losing your life, just your life. Sort of like no one's gonna take away your house, they just burn it down and make you live there. Which is better, I guess? To silence a rival without the risky coin toss of challenging them to a duel, rumor, gossip, and ridicule were the weapons of choice, and permanent exile was the goal. Let's say a powerful noble, the Minister of Foreign Affairs maybe, dislikes a newcomer to the court. Let's call him Count Saint Germain. To get rid of the guy, the minister goes to his rumor mill, an honest-to-God workshop he keeps outside Paris that has the sole purpose of creating mocking songs, damaging lies, and critical publications. The minister gets the bright idea of hiring an actor who looks and sounds just like Saint Germain, right down to his clothing and speech patterns. Then he sends this actor around to the popular Paris salons, which the real Saint Germain had yet to visit. The actor is introduced as Count Saint Germain, and makes a complete ass of himself. He claims to be an immortal time traveler who advised Jesus. Really. The antics of jerkface imposter guy get mixed up with the actions of the real man. It's so effective in damaging his reputation that the minister can later convince the king that Saint Germain is a lying dirtbag who deserves an international arrest warrant, which the king grants, and voila, Saint Germain can never come back to France. 260 years later, Count Saint Germain shows up in a Netflix cartoon as a lying time-traveling weirdo. So to say the art of character assassination reached its peak in 18th century Paris is like saying the Chinese built a pretty big wall, or the Puritans were a bit uptight. And as far as these things go, the destruction of Étienne de Silhouette was a masterpiece. Catchy poems and songs claimed Silhouette was out to tax everything but the air in our lungs. Others claimed he was destroying the natural order of society. Others suggested corruption, that Silhouette was making himself rich by taxing everyone else. In early summer, the citizens of Paris had thrown flowers at Silhouette's feet. But by late fall, his popular image had shattered, and when the bankers, nobles, and the frickin' clergy all came to the king demanding he get rid of Silhouette, that was it. The king's representative came to collect his resignation. Étienne de Silhouette had only been on the job for 8 months. At some point during this entire campaign of destruction against Silhouette, the talking took a particularly French turn. The French language has a specific speech pattern where they take a thing and add a la something to it to specify a style or variation of whatever it was they were talking about in the first place. It creates these little spin-off sayings, thing a la blah. A la whatever literally means to the whatever. But in practice, it means according to, or in the style of. At some point along the way, Étienne de Silhouette got whacked with the a la whatever stick. Members of the nobility started labeling things a la Silhouette, which they decided meant in the style of the cheapest, crappiest version of whatever thing. A popular fashion of slender coats over pants with no pockets became culottes à la silhouette. Because, haha, we don't need a place to put our coin purse since silhouette took all our money. Turning a popular fashion into a way to complain that you don't have anywhere to put your extra money because now you have to pay taxes has got to be the whiniest rich person protest I've ever heard. But it wasn't just clothing that got the à la silhouette treatment. At the time, the only way to get a likeness made of yourself was to pay somebody to paint you onto a canvas or to carve your face into a rock, neither of which was particularly affordable, and photography wouldn't be invented for another 60-ish years. But there was this new budget method for making a portrait. All you had to do was trace your shadow in profile, cut it out of dark cardboard, and slap it on a white background. That was it. That was the whole process, which made this new style of portraiture a functionally instant way to capture your unique features, from the right to the left. Cheap, quick, looked a bit like unfinished work, it didn't take long before portrait à la silhouette started trending. And that's the connection. That's why silhouette's name is now a word that means the same thing in English, French, Portuguese, Spanish, German, Japanese, and Russian. So that kind of does it for the word, but it leaves out any explanation of why nobody's ever heard of, you know, silhouette. ...1759 was a terrible year for France. Their navy was decimated, their armies were routed, it lost its empire in America, India, and the Caribbean. And the military's overly ambitious plan to invade Britain never happened. Just like every movie shot in 2019, it wound up being an incredibly expensive production that nobody got to see. It really couldn't have gone worse for France. I mean, here's a book called 1759, The Year Britain Became Master of the World. Silhouette might have titled it 1759, My New Job Went Poorly. Étienne de Silhouette has to be one of the luckiest, unlucky people who has ever lived. He got this close to turning his ideas into real, positive changes on a huge scale. But if you and yours were part of the French elite, those changes looked like an existential threat. And if you happened to be responsible for the recent failures of France, Silhouette also looked like a potential scapegoat. It's not enough to just destroy Silhouette's name and position. Not if the next chuckle do-gooder can just saunter in and start all over. To truly eliminate this threat, the actions of Étienne de Silhouette, his work, had to become a black hole that sucked up and destroyed anyone stupid enough to come near it. His name, his reputation, his ideas, all had to become an ungraspable void where nothing could grow. And so, anyone who has anything positive to say about the exiled Silhouette is mercilessly punished. None other than Jean-Jacques Rousseau mentioned he wrote Silhouette a letter right after he was fired. Even though he never sent it, a copy of the letter was shown around in Paris. And for just this privately scrawled compliment, Rousseau was isolated and lost friends. Which doesn't sound like much, but again, remember what reputation was worth at the time. Anyone who had the misfortune to work with or under Silhouette was moved to a position that didn't matter, or was exiled themselves. It didn't take very long for people to get the message. Every writer of the day piled on. They repeat as true a rumor that Silhouette took a huge pension for himself, even while he canceled everybody else's. Wartime losses were blamed on him turning the economy upside down. 8 years after his exile, when one author heard Silhouette had died, he writes that it was stifled ambition that killed him. But after they got done reversing all of Silhouette's policies, France again had a problem. Because you can fire the guy, but you can't fire crippling budget deficit. The kingdom had to enact a flurry of new taxes, and pretty much all of them were aimed at the common people. And just to make sure Silhouette's legacy is thoroughly destroyed, officials claim these new taxes are necessary to fix the damage done by Silhouette's financial mismanagement. For their efforts, the French elite buy themselves another 20-ish years of decadent living, before the French people get so fed up that they grab their pitchforks and start collecting heads. 40 years before the revolution, they'd ignored Silhouette when he said the French navy needed an overhaul or they'd lose to the British, which they did. 20 years after that, they ignored him when he said the economy needed an overhaul, or there'd be a violent revolution, which there was. Eventually, the choice to continually ignore Silhouette's recommendations led to a rich noblewoman named Marie Antoinette losing her head to the guillotine. And given that history, I can confidently say that if irony made things heavier, this picture would swallow the goddamn universe. There's a few loose ends to tie up with this whole story. The most important of those loose ends is the other story of how we got the word silhouette. The foundation of this story is the idea that Étienne de Silhouette himself was a proficient artist at making silhouettes. It's this story that's repeated most often online, and this story also is wrong. The art of drawing or cutting silhouettes exploded in popularity into the 1800s. Some artists became so skilled, they could accurately cut out your profile freehand, without tracing anything. But the fact is, to get good at any art form, you have to practice, and usually someone has to teach you. It seems likely that in one of those teaching sessions, some student asked a teacher where the name came from, and not wanting to look stupid in front of his class by mumbling, he just made the story up. It's not like anyone had Google in their pocket to call him on his bullshit, but there's just no evidence Étienne de Silhouette ever made a silhouette, or had one made for him. Though, without this random art form suddenly gaining popularity, it's probable that we wouldn't remember the name Silhouette at all. His name was attached to dozens of different products, and none of them bear his name today. Which is probably because muttering a la silhouette after everything is kind of a pain in the ass. Those few people who would giggle and congratulate each other every time one of them told a la silhouette joke mostly died in the revolution. If the rest of us are looking for a bargain, we just say, hey, what's on sale? Not, you got anything a la silhouette? People aren't really known for doing more work than they have to, and the words we already had were easier to say. By the same token, Silhouette's name stuck to the art form because, unlike everything else, we didn't already have a name for it. It's pretty annoying to have to ask for, you know, a portrait, but not a painting because I don't want to spend a lot of money. So maybe just like from one side and in one color? At some point, you're gonna just say, look, have you heard of a silhouette? Great, do that. And 20 years after the death of Étienne de Silhouette, the word silhouette was added to the Dictionary of Common Nouns. It was a bunch of nobles being jerks that started this whole thing, but it was really convenience and repetition that got us across the finish line. The last loose end is what happened to the man himself. Silhouette sold everything he had and bought a chateau outside Paris. It's there he lived out the rest of his life. But before he died, he used the remainder of his fortune to take care of the people who lived on his land. He brought infrastructure, education, and medical care to the people around him, creating in miniature what he was unable to do on a national scale. Though he was married, Étienne de Silhouette and his wife never had any children, and he died not long after she did in 1768. As far as I can tell, it wasn't stifled ambition that killed him, unless that happens to look exactly like a chest infection. Even when he died, the word silhouette was a synonym for ridiculous. He didn't live long enough to see his name used for anything positive. However, just a few years ago, a school also got the name Silhouette. This school is located in the town where Silhouette spent his exile, and it was named for him by the descendants of the people who knew him in his last years of life. It's a gesture that doesn't bring back the man or undo what was done to him. And really, compared to a word used in six or seven languages, having your name stuck on a school is kind of small potatoes. Except that this is something named after him, the man. And it was given his name intentionally to recognize his actions in life. Which means that the effort to erase those actions failed. And it means that though he paid a heavy price for his life's work, the work remains. And really, what more could you want? Hello. I'm not really a fan of these after-the-video little segments that beg you for help. To me, when I've said everything I need to in the episode's done. But I do want to keep doing this, so I do need some help. Making content for YouTube and a few other platforms is everything I wanted it to be. It's also a f*** load of work. To be successful on this platform, the only thing I can do is make the best content I can as often as possible. But weirdly, the rest isn't really up to me. When I say that I owe the previous and hopefully future success of this channel to you, the viewers, I'm not just saying that. Here's what I mean. YouTube's algorithm doesn't care what I make. It only cares what you make of it. Simply watching a video all the way to the end, coming back if you're a subscriber for the next video, liking a video, commenting on a video, all of those things are things that the algorithm takes into account when it decides whether or not to show the video to a new viewer. Those kinds of interactions really don't cost you anything, and they really are what determines the success of this channel. So if you enjoyed that video, please interact in some way with the video or another one on the channel. You don't have to smash the like button, but I would deeply appreciate it if you would gently click it. If you want to take it a step further, the number one thing you could do to help the channel is sharing a video somewhere else on the internet. Please don't just spam links somewhere. I mean, you can, I'm not gonna mind. But if you're having some sort of other conversation online and it makes you think of an episode on the channel, please drop a link. If you really, really super duper want to help me create more episodes like this one, you can become a member over on the channel's Patreon page if you so desire. Kind of like all these people did, to whom I owe my eternal thanks. Finally, a quick thank you to Thierry Maugenet for his amazing biography on Silhouette. If you want to learn more about Étienne de Silhouette, who is amazing, this biography is available on Amazon, but it's in French. Right now, there isn't an English translation of it. If you know how to do that or are interested in making that happen, get in touch. Going forward, videos will also have a link in the description to a complete list of sources on medium.com. A few quick stats on this particular video as I fade out. I started writing this video January 15th, started editing it January 16th, and like a week later found out all that information was wrong and had to reshoot the whole thing. The project file for this episode is 407 gigabytes, spread across 1,320 files. And it probably took somewhere in the neighborhood of 300 to 400, 500 hours of work. So when I say I hope you enjoyed it, I really, really mean that. More to come soon. I'll see you next time.